Good morning and welcome to Blaine Christian Church. Where is everybody? Strange morning. Maybe they're all just running late. Welcome, Pastor David, Sue, and we're a little light up here this morning, so you're going to all have to sing really, really loud. There are lots of announcements, so take the opportunity to go through these. One thing I really, really, really want to highlight is out on the table, there are some cards, and these are invitations that you can take and take the opportunity to be a disciple. Invite someone to come to our celebration on the 12th of December. It is going to be a wonderful, wonderful day with just all kinds of things happening, and it's our opportunity to share the love of Christ. So friends, neighbors, people that you don't know, take the opportunity to say hello and invite them. And that's also the first Sunday that we will be back in starting our Christian Ed program. So it's just going to be a great day. Can we all greet each other with the peace of Christ and stand and sing our worship songs?
You can have So fall's coming, and with fall comes football season. Football's a big deal at our house, especially college football. And it's a fun sport, but to play it, you need lots of protection. So I pulled out a picture of a football player this morning, and it shows that he needs a helmet and pads here and pads here and special shoes. And it got me to thinking about things that, you know, he'd never go into the game with all that protection on because he knows he needs it to do what he needs to do. And today in our Bible lesson, we're going to hear about the protection that we need in our lives too. And the Bible calls it the armor of God, which protects us from Satan's evil plans for us. So here's the kind of protection the Bible says we need. And I have this little statue that someone gave me when we did the studies a while ago about it. So I brought this today too to show the kids just the different things. So it says we need on our belt, around our middle here, the belt of truth, because Satan will lie to us. But if we have the belt of truth around us, we'll know the truth that Jesus is Lord. We need the breastplate of righteousness around us. Satan can harm us when we choose. Satan can't never harm us when we choose to do what God says is right. Our feet are fitted with the gospel of peace. Satan tries to create worry and confusion in our lives. But knowing Jesus brings us peace. The shield of faith, this big shield here. Satan will try to plant seeds of doubt in our lives and in our hearts. But those seeds of doubt can't take root if we have faith in Jesus. And then the helmet of salvation. Jesus came to save us. And if we know Jesus, then we will win the battle against Satan. And then the sword of the Spirit right here. The sword of the Spirit, the Bible, God's holy word, is a powerful weapon against Satan. So each day we need to think about it. Just like a football player puts on all his gear before he goes into a game, we need to go mentally through our list and put on our gear so that we're ready to walk faithfully with Jesus and be who Jesus is calling us to be. So let's pray. Father, we just need to know you and to each day step before you and pull on our gear as we go out to face the world you've placed us in. Help us to be your lights and to shine brightly for your son, Jesus. Amen.
Please bow your heads and join me in a prayer for illumination. Father, our guide, illuminate our minds so we can understand how you want us to live. Your word tells us that people of integrity who follow your instructions are joyful. You have said that those who obey your laws and search for you with all their hearts are blessed and happy. We want that joy. Holy Spirit, please guard us against allowing evil to influence what we do and believe. Help us to walk only in your paths. May our actions consistently reflect what you have said is right and good. Amen. The first reading this morning comes from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians, chapter 6. Verses 10 through 20, and you can find that on page 950 in the Pew Bible. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all of this, pick up your shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take on the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. This is the word of God.
I kind of get all pumped up about that because I like football season too. And I like the armor of God. And my little bench was stolen. How's everyone? Massive crowd today that we have here. It's a little disconcerting, isn't it? Today I'm going to read from John, the book Gospel of John, John 6, 56 through 69. Hear the word of the Lord. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them, just as the living Father sent me. And I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me, will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. He said this while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. On hearing it, many of his disciples said, "This is hard teaching. Who can accept it?" Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The Spirit gives life, the flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of the Spirit and life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe." For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him. He went on to say, "This is why I've told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled them." From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. "You do not want to leave too, do you?" Jesus asked the 12. Simon Peter answered, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." Blessed be his word. Last week, we celebrated the youth of this church on VBS Sunday. The theme of the week of Vacation Bible School was centered on what Jesus's power does for us. There were four biblical truths that the children learned throughout that week. The first point was Jesus' power helps us do hard things. And this was brought to light in Philippians 4:13. "For you can do everything through Christ who gives you strength." The second point, Jesus' power gives us hope. Psalms 31:24 says, "So be strong and courageous, all who put your hope in the Lord." Third point, Jesus' power helps us be bold. That comes from Isaiah 40:29, which reveals he gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. And finally, Jesus' power helps us to be good friends. That's found in John 15:12, where he tells us, "Love each other in the same way that I have loved you." The theme of Vacation Bible School was about power, not just any power, but Jesus' power to help us in our times of need. Why did we spend an entire week talking about Jesus' power to help us? Why didn't we spend the week of speaking of love and peace and the joyful celebration of our earthly bonds? Well, the children were taught about Jesus' power to help them understand where their strength comes if they are a believer in Christ Jesus. The need to teach our children about power The power of Jesus is due to the many attacks that we face each and every day, attacks that cause us fear. Did you know that study reveals the number one fear that people have? Speaking in public. The number two fear? Death. That's right. You heard it. Death is number two to public speaking. Jerry Seinfeld must have had it right when he said to the average person, if you go to a funeral, you're better off in the casket than doing the eulogy. What the children were taught in VBS is that there is a place we can go to find power, a power that will never let us go and will help us to overcome our fears. There are reasons that we need power, even greater power than is required to speak in public. Jesus understood this need for power and made it clear where he would turn in his time of need. When Jesus was about to be arrested, he went and prayed. He told his disciples with him, pray that you will not fall into temptation. Then Jesus prayed, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. Jesus turned to the Father for strength and power to complete his task. Jesus understood that the forces of evil that are present on this earth, and he knew that he would need strength and power to complete the task set before him. In today's gospel reading, the disciples' fears are pretty evident. In the Gospel of John, Jesus tells his followers, made up of his disciples, very truly I tell you, unless you eat of the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. The disciples, upon hearing this, stated, this is hard teaching. Who can accept it? Then many of the disciples, negating the 12, turned back and no longer followed him. Imagine the fears of the disciples. Imagine the fears the disciples must have faced as they transitioned from Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem to the death on the cross. In my mind, I can see the joyful procession and Jesus riding on a colt, a sign that the Messiah, the earthly king, had arrived. I can see people running from all over the countryside. Can't you see them coming from the hills? Towards the city. They're telling their neighbors, the men are leaving the plows in the field. The women have bread in the oven, but it's all left behind. They're gathering up their children and they're running with their cloaks to lay on the ground and they're finding palms to wave in jubilation. Their king has arrived. But the week progresses. Jesus is arrested. He's put on trial and they see it. They, the followers of Jesus, the cloak laying, the palm waving, the joyous shouting followers of Jesus, they see it. They see the cross. What do? They run out of fear. Even the disciples who didn't leave when Jesus spoke of eating flesh and drinking blood, they ran. Peter denied knowing Jesus. Judas killed himself, and the remainder hid. The cross scared the followers of Jesus. And in the years following Jesus' death and resurrection, the cross scared many, many more people. And I still think it scares people today. We have a hard time talking about its reality. We soften its meaning by making it beautiful jewelry out of it, mounting it as art on our walls, and placing cross stickers on the back of our cars. But the reality that God could use it as a means to accomplish the gift of salvation, well, that's scary to people. Jesus asked the direct question, does this offend you? The reality of the cross is the reality of what we must overcome on this earth as we approach that cross. Although we enjoy religious freedom in America, for which I am eternally grateful, there are so many places in this world where people have to read the Bible, worship, and pray in secret. The latest actions in Afghanistan by the Taliban reveal the dangers of following the cross, that the dangers of following the cross are still very present today. The idea that we can worship God freely here in America, well, that's truly a gift from God. However, even with the gift of freedom of religion, we are faced with many battles as Christians. In our first reading today, the Apostle Paul brings to light this war that is waged against, Paul brings to light this war that is waged against Christians and why we need to teach children about the power of Jesus, like we did in VBS last week. Paul states that you will have to stand against the devil's schemes, for our struggle is not against the flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Why do we need Jesus' power? According to the Bible, there are three forces of evil that we have to fight against: the world, the flesh, and the devil. We see that the world is evil in the book of James, as he speaks to us as saying, "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God." As we read this verse, don't you wonder what the author of James meant when he spoke of being a friend of this world? He may be referring to the desiring the things of this world that take us away from God, and those are called idols. In 1 Peter 2, Peter speaks of the desires of the flesh as a point of evil, as he states, "Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your souls." Sinful desires are spoken of in terms of, sinful desires are spoken of in terms of those desires that want to please the flesh. The Apostle Paul describes these desires of the flesh very clearly in the book of Galatians. Paul includes the following: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, dissensions, rivalries, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. These are the desires of the flesh. Finally, 1 Peter 5:8 reveals the devil's presence. "Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion for someone to devour." It's very clear there is an evil presence on this earth, a fallen angel who seeks to destroy us through the lies and tricks that take us away from God. So, what do we do about this? Luckily, the Apostle Paul tells us of the tools that we have to fight against the evils of this world. Paul tells us to put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Before we move forward to the actual tools to defend ourselves in this battle, I want to make sure that you notice one word that is used repetitively in today's service, at least in Ephesians. The word is stand. Listen to how it's used. "Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes." Paul continues, "Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything to stand, stand firm then." When you read this, you might wonder, is that good warfare? I did. After all, where is the offensive move coming from in standing your ground? Standing doesn't seem like a way to win a war or a battle. In fact, it seems somewhat ineffective and passive. However, as we consider the tactics of the Roman army, you'll begin to understand how important standing was. The Roman army learned of from another group of warriors, the Spartans. I'll say go green, go white, but that the frontline forces carried large shields that were rectangular in shape. As they approached the enemy, the front line of the Roman army would complete a tactical move called turtling or turtle. They would lock their shields together, forming a wall and a cover. This made any attempt to shoot arrows or fire catapults useless. When the enemy became so frustrated, they would try to advance their troops and break into the turtle, which caused them to tire. At this point, the Roman cavalry would come in from the sides and decimate the enemy's front line. With this in mind, the idea of standing, let's look at the way we are armed to do battle against the evils of this world. Paul begins with the belt of truth around your waist. Within a soldier's tools, especially a Roman soldier, the belt was one of the major pieces of equipment, as the belt held everything together. The tunic would be held in check, the breastplate would be fastened to it, the sword would hang from it. If the belt is weak and breaks, everything falls apart. Likewise, for the Christian, truth is the one thing we use to hold everything together. That is why the truth of the gospel is so important to us. If we falter and move away from the truth, if we tell white lies, if we align our views with the world's by compromising the gospel, then everything in our armor falls apart. You may be thinking that understanding the truth and being truthful is pretty obvious for standing our ground. However, consider our country's views of the truth. In the 1960s, 65% of Americans said they believe the Bible is true. Today, that figure has dropped to 32%, less than half. Even more dramatically, 67% of all Americans deny that there's any such thing as truth. 70% say there are no moral absolutes. The bottom line, you better tighten your belts. Next, Paul points to the breastplate of righteousness. In preparation for this sermon, I read several articles that noted how many of the authors were quick to point out that the breastplate of righteousness is often mistaken. Sometimes we confuse the word righteousness as an action that we produce ourselves. However, in this context, we need to consider the breastplate of righteousness in conjunction with our relationship with Jesus Christ. The only way we have gained righteousness is through justification. And that justification comes through the saving grace given by Jesus. It is not something we can produce. When we put our trust in, or when we put on our Jesus as our breastplate, every flaming arrow shot by the devil will be pushed aside. Next, Paul moves to the feet, as your feet are fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. When I think of a soldier preparing for battle, for some reason, I have a memory of the movie Forrest Gump, as Gump's commanding officer, Lieutenant Dan, explained the importance of good footwear. Lieutenant Dan said, "There is one item of GI gear that can be the difference between a live grunt and a dead grunt. Socks, cushion, sole, OD green. Try to keep your feet dry when you're out humping. I want you boys to remember to change your socks whenever we stop." The importance of footwear is true for the Christian as well. Our feet need to hold on to something that will give us stability and stand firm. It must protect our feet and give us stability. In life, there are times that we try to stand on things like secular politics or social issues. Standing on these items force us away from the solid ground provided by the gospel, and then we slip and fall away from the truth. Now Paul describes the shield of faith. As I mentioned earlier, the shield is a very important tool for the Roman soldier. Generally, the soldier's shield was very large, much larger than it's predicted there. And they would soak it in water before battle. This would allow the shield to extinguish any flaming arrows shot by the enemy. For you and I, the shield of faith represents the faith that we proclaim when we gave ourselves to Jesus Christ. This faith gives us the power to extinguish the devil's arrows and feel in the form of doubt, fear, and unbelief. Paul then points to the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit. The helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit are linked together. The helmet of salvation covers our head and protects our minds against the lies created by Satan and man. This allows us to be able to use the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Just a little note here. The Greek word used in this section is not the word logos, which means written word. The Greek word used here is the word rhema, which is the spoken word of God. The sword of the Spirit is the word of God spoken by us to help others in understanding the truth that is present in our relationship with Christ Jesus. The Lord has provided each and every one of us with the equipment necessary to fight the evils of this world and to overcome the tactics of Satan. Now, I'd like to challenge each of you to think about these tools every single morning, just like Carolyn said, as you get dressed and prepare for the day that you will face. As you pull your shirt over the head, think about the breastplate of righteousness and how Jesus' sacrifice and how through Jesus' sacrifice, you are justified and made righteous to the Lord. As you think about this righteousness, think about the instructions that you receive from the Lord. If there's an area in your life in which you are struggling with a sin, ask a church leader or a very trusted friend to share a piece of scripture that might help you to follow the Lord's plan better. When you pull on your socks and put on your shoes, imagine the Lord enveloping you with the gospel of peace. The peace that we receive when we understand and believe the gospel of Christ, that the gospel of Christ allows us to shake loose of anxiety and worry that this world creates. The gospel of peace will always allow you to stand firm with the Lord and be anchored in the peace of Jesus Christ. Next, when you bring your belt around the waist, imagine that you are anchoring yourself in God's word. Not just the part of it that pertains to one aspect of your life, but the whole Bible. By anchoring yourself in the whole of God's word, you can begin to look at the world through the lens of the Bible. I think this is incredibly important in today's society, as it seems to want to look at the Bible through the lens of the world, which distorts and misguides people away from God's truth. When you comb your hair and put on your hat, imagine the helmet of salvation being put on your head. We recognize that salvation is a gift that comes to us when we place our faith in Jesus Christ and believe in his death and resurrection as God's Son. As we go through this journey of salvation, we need to recognize that the main battlefield is within our own mind. To help overcome the negative thoughts, we need to have scripture on our mind through the renewing of God's word. You might do this by adding a daily devotion to your morning. I notice that there are two devotions out on there. There are daily devotions out on the table. Grab one as you go. You might do it by adding an app on your phone that gives you a verse for the day, or joining a Bible study. According to Romans 12:2, Paul tells us not to conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is good, pleasing, and perfect will. Next, when you put on your jacket or coat, which I'm afraid will happen pretty soon, think about the shield of faith provided through the hearing of God's word. As you think about faith, you may want to change your focus a bit. Rather than simply focusing on your faith in God, allow yourself to focus on the faith of God's character and his faith in you. God promises that there is nothing that can separate us from his love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today or our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell, can separate us from the love of God. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed, nothing in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. In other words, God's got this. A little sign out there that says that. Whatever this is for you, he's got it. Finally, when you take that pen in your hand, when you begin to speak or you begin to type on that computer, think about the sword of the Spirit. You have the ability to use your words, written or spoken, to reveal or dismiss God's truth. When Jesus was tempted in the wilderness by the devil, he responded with, "Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Do not put your Lord, your God, to the test. And worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Notice that Jesus didn't turn away and make up his own statements. He turned to the Word of God to thwart the devil's schemes. When you get dressed every morning, you have an opportunity to either arm yourself or to disarm yourself. You can allow the world, the flesh, or the devil to lead by allowing them to pull on the chains of your desire, or you can allow Christ to crucify the evils of the world by surrendering to him and arming yourself with his armor. And all God's people said, would you please join us in singing our hymn of praise?
So cool, because I see so many nice smiles out there. Oh, and there's another one right there. Thank you for being here.
I invite you to listen to the Holy Spirit, and if you feel so moved, to make a confession of faith or to recommit yourself to that confession of faith, or you'd simply like to become a member of Blaine Church, please come forward.
I believe he's here now. Thank you. We have an opportunity now to come to the Lord with our prayers. If you have a concern and would like to share that, or if you have a praise and would like to share that, I'm going to start with sharing the family of Gary and Carolyn Watterson. Lost Gary's father, Alan, this past week. And so as I talked to Gary, that is both a prayer for peace within the family, but also a praise because his father is with our Father in heaven now.
I asked for prayer a couple of weeks ago for my niece, my great nieces, Ada and Bella. Mm-hmm. And I just want to say thank you for your prayers. They're both doing better. Bella's out of the hospital and living with her mom now. Mm-hmm. And Ada is in school and beginning to adjust to all of the new situation at my sister's house, at her grandma's.
Okay.
They still need our prayers. Please don't stop praying for them. But they're doing so much better. And she knows and I know that it's the prayers of God's people.
Thank you. What was his name? That's awesome. 100 years old. Did the president call him or governor? I think so. They normally do. Anyone else?
We have a bunch of them here. A friend of mine, Stan, who's been very serious in the hospital with COVID. A sister-in-law in the hospital with COVID. Brother-in-law, Ron, he's had a knee replacement last week. And then my daughter, Dale, was injured in a windstorm.
That windstorm was something downstate. My wife can attest to that. She was down in Branch County at the time.
I just want to share, in the Eid prayers, there was a note about David, Dave Sadia, did I say that right?
Sweda.
Okay.
Sweda. Yeah.
And it had to send cards to the address, to an address in Bear Lake. He said, send them to Sandy Merrick's address, and then he will actually get them.
Sandy Merrick's address, okay.
And he loves having phone calls, even like talking to me. And I don't even know.
I can understand that, Bonnie. All right. Would you join me in prayer? Father in heaven, creator of all things, we come to you this morning fully aware of your power and might. You have carved out this earth with beauty and majesty, and you are the author of life. You are mighty and strong, yet you save us with great mercy through the sacrifice of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Almighty Father, you knew each of us intimately. You know each of us intimately. Your heart is full of love, and still you watch over us in our weakness and provide us with the tools to stand firm against the evils present on this earth. Lord, as we come to you this morning, we recognize our own failings as we sin and are inadequate to deserve your grace. Yet you provide grace that we cannot measure. We are thankful for the blessings and grace that you have provided each and every day. We recognize that you have far greater understanding for our needs and that you guide our steps as we attempt to serve you. Help us to be faithful to your direction and your desires. Almighty Father, on this day, we recognize that there are people in our midst who are hurting due to physical ailments or psychological challenges. We know that you will provide healing and strength for those that we pray for. Lord, on this day, we ask that you be with the family of Gary Watterson in the passing of his father, Alan. We ask that you help them find the joy in joining you in the heavenly realms. We pray for Ada and Bella and are thankful that they are doing better. Just continue to help them in their new surroundings. We give great thanks for Leo Wilcox's 100th birthday and the opportunity for Pete and his family to be with him. Continue to watch over Dave Suda and his health issues. Allow him to be strengthened. We also pray for Stan and Kathy, who both have COVID, and all those who are fighting that disease. We ask that you help Ron heal from his knee replacement and allow Dale to heal from her head injury at the fair. Lord, please be with those that we have prayed for. Please calm their hearts and free their minds. Heal their bodies and their lives as well. Lord, we ask special blessing be placed on Pastor Bob and Deb as they continue their sabbatical. Allow this to be a time of renewal, rejoicing, and rejuvenation. Strengthen them through your Holy Spirit and guide them through their learning and travels. Father in heaven, we know that you answer prayers in your way and in your time. Help us to release our anxiety for these concerns to you this day. Guide us in our walk with your Son and help us to pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus offers us power to defend against the evils of this world, our flesh, and the devil's schemes. Today, as we approach the table, and please feel the power of Christ Jesus through his sacrifice.
Jesus, no words can express our gratitude and amazement that you should die for us. How amazing it is that each of our lives is so valuable to you that you would lay your life down to reach us. May this bread and juice remain with us as we seek to take your message of love and grace into the world. Amen.
On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. After giving thanks, he broke it and said, Whenever you eat of this, remember me. Then he took the cup, said, This is my blood given for you. It is the blood of the new covenant. Whenever you drink of it and eat of it, remember me. Please come and join us.
Thank you.
Our benediction today comes from Galatians 1, verses 3 and 4. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of God our Father. Amen. Go in peace. Thank you.